Good morning, I am live. I'm reading out of Return to Elysium. It is a book by Joan Marshall Grant. It is one of her far memories, and it plays in ancient Egypt, 2nd century BC, on an island called Elysium. She grew up on another island where it was only her and two other people, and she is now on Elysium. She got there by boat on her own, and she's there for her education. This is the 5th chapter, and it's entitled Lamplight. The western headland of the bay was joined to the rest of Elysium by a narrow neck of land, and the cliffs were steep enough to make it almost as secluded as an island. On it was a deserted house, a small white house, protected from the north by ancient pines. It looked an interesting place to explore, but one of the servants told me it was haunted. I asked Asclepius about the ghost, but instead of being helpful, he said impatiently that ghosts had no existence save in the inferior minds of the credulous. I could not question the servant, for he was sent away from Elysium that same evening. I wondered why Asclepius had been so annoyed, especially when he maintained that curiosity was the primary virtue. He used to say, "Answering questions is the privilege of the philosophers, and they remain philosophers just so long as they remember there are always more answers to discover." If ghosts did not exist, why was the house abandoned? Why was the path leading to it from the mainland overgrown by brambles? After careful thought, I decided that it might be wiser to avoid the place until I knew more about it, about ghosts and what to do if I met one. In calm weather, it was easy to go beyond the headland, for there was a ledge of rock between the cliff and the deep water which led to a long sandy beach. I sometimes went there for a solitary walk, usually after I had been defeated in an argument and wanted to enjoy a comfortable quarrel inside my head, in which I always made witty remarks instead of thinking of them too late. It was on one of these occasions, a cold afternoon in early spring, that I was too busy being clever to notice black clouds driving up against the wind. Thunder suddenly roared. I knew it was only a natural phenomenon, but it would have been easy to believe that the sound was made by gods bellowing to each other, angry gods, probably angry with me. I could not help remembering the tree I had seen struck by lightning. If Zeus decided to aim his fire at me, I should soon look like a carcass left too long in the oven. I tried to laugh at myself, but the joke seemed too probable to be funny. I wanted to get home very quickly, not only because it had begun to rain. Waves were dashing against the cliffs and the ledge was underwater. If I tried to cross it, I should be sucked into the sea by the undertow. Could I swim? Swim round? That sea was too rough. I should be driven on the roads before I could get beyond the headland. If I went back along the beach, there was another way home, but it was much further and it would soon be dark. I should have to pass close to the deserted house. Did the ghost inhabit the garden too? I began to run, which is never sensible when you're frightened. The steps were slippery with spray. I fell and grazed my knee. At the top there was a solitary pine, its branches dark and tormented against the livid sky. The wind was so strong that I had to cling to the tree to stop myself being blown over the cliff. The rough bark was strangely reassuring, the only protection in a world of hostile water. I should have to shelter in the empty house until the storm lessened, until I could fight my way through the brambles which barred the way home. The shutters of the west window were swinging in the lash of the gale. As I pulled myself up the sill, the broken plaster of the outer wall stripped the skin from my other knee. Lightning showed me a long, narrow room, the walls frescoed with faded lilies. The shutters creaked disconsolately. like the knee joints of some very old. I tried to close them, but the bolt was too stiff with rust. I crouched against the wall for protection. In the glare of another flash, the painted lilies watched me, scornful of the girl who huddled beside their placid stalks. Why had I thought the room was empty? There was a bed and a painted chest under the east window. A woman was lying in the bed, a woman with honey-coloured hair tangled on the pillow. She was asleep, breathing very slowly. I could see the green coverlet move with the shallow rise and fall of her breast. I could hear water dripping in the sudden silence. Water dripping from my hair, small, precise drops marking the passing time. The woman opened her eyes. Sea green under the weary lids, I tried to speak to her, to tell her she was no longer alone. I felt my lips move, but the sea was too loud for her to hear me. A child came into the room, a child with curly hair, bound with a fillet of pale flowers. She carried a lamp, shielding the small flame carefully with her hand. The wind must have died down, for I could hear the soft fall of the child's bare feet on the tiled floor. The child stumbled. She had caught her foot in the fold of the small carpet near the bed. The carpet was brown, with a pattern of white deer. She began to cry, and the oil from her lamp spilled on the floor, spreading into a narrow pool of light. The woman got up from the bed slowly, as though she were afraid of falling. I saw her straighten herself and move towards the child. She took the lamp, and the flame was steady, a much brighter flame, for they were no longer in shadow. The child looked up at her, the tears glittering on its lashes. They smiled at each other, and hand in hand went to the far window. I heard the shutters open and saw the sun rise. Then the light was too bright for me to see them. Someone was shouting outside the house, "Lucina! Lucina, where are you?" "Here," my voice sounded very loud in the quiet room. Where was here? Why was I lying on the floor? Why was I wet and shuddering with cold? Against the green, storm-clean sky, I saw Euripides climbing through the window. "I saw you on the headland. I came back to look for you when I realized you couldn't have reached the path before I did. Were you frightened by the thunder?" "Only when I dropped the lamp before she held it for us." I could only see his face as a shape against the sky, but I knew he was staring at me. "Something has happened, Lucina. What is it? You're still frightened." He bent down and lifted me from the floor. He smelt of wet wood and warm human skin. I clung to him, hiding my face against his shoulder. "I'm going to make a fire," he said. "I left dry wood in the next room when I was there last month. There is even a towel and an old cloak that I use after bathing." I watched him coax the pine knots into a strong flame. I sat close to the hearth, hugging my knees to try to keep myself from shivering. He took off my wet clothes and rubbed me with a rough towel until I began to feel warmth creeping back to my body. Then he wrapped me in his cloak, which smelled of seaweed, and sat with his arm around me in the firelight. "What happened to you, Lucina? You needn't be afraid to tell me. I shan't laugh, for I know there is something here." "How do you know?" I wanted to tell him, but it would be terrible if he could not believe in what I had seen. "Shall I tell you why I come here? Then you needn't say anything if you feel I wouldn't understand." "Yes," I said, but please, don't be angry if I don't tell you anything." "Why should I be angry? We can both pretend nothing happened except a thunderstorm." He threw another log on the fire and I leant against his shoulder. "I came here for the first time 3 months ago for the very ordinary reason that I thought it would be a good place to work in when no one would interrupt. I meant to go on with a play about the Trojan War, but I started to write something entirely different. I felt the characters belonged to this house, and instead of having to create the background, it flowed quite naturally into the pattern. I knew even such small details as clothes and furniture. The only curious thing was that time went backwards instead of forwards. It began with a woman dying. She died in the other room. On a bed facing the south window? Yes. And I think there was a child's bed in the room, but I'm not sure of this. I'm uncertain about the age of the child. Sometimes I think she was a baby, and then I cross that out and make her about 3 years old. She had pale yellow hair, like the mother. Go on. Please go on. The woman had a rare stillness, as though she listened for a sound on the edge of silence. She was content to drift in the current of the seasons, as though her world held nothing more complex than the sound of the sea, or the tranquil patterns of trees against the sky. But she had to guard her quietness, building it like a fragile shell cupped in her hands. She had suffered some great sorrow, and only by a deliberate forgetting could she protect her unborn child. She knew that if she let herself remember, it would be so very easy to die, I said softly. And when the child was born? Then she dared to believe, to relieve the past, to remember the love that was stranger than any other reality. She wanted to find my father, but she couldn't go to him unless she was sure I was strong enough to carry my own lamp. Euripides, why didn't you tell me that my mother died here? Because I didn't know until you told me. We walked home under a sky of many stars. Euripides wanted me to go straight to bed and not see Asclepius until the morning. But how could I sleep with so many questions unanswered? I went to his room, though it was understood that he was not to be disturbed after the evening meal unless by his express invitation. Is anything wrong, Lucina? You appear agitated. I hope you found adequate shelter from the storm. Most adequate, I said, in the room where my mother died, in the house on the headland where I was born. Why did you lie to me? He paused as though considering whether evasion was still practicable. I considered it wiser to conceal the circumstances of your birth until you were older. Then you admit I was born in Elysium? Have I ever denied it? You said my mother was a patient of yours in Athens, that you promised to look after me until she was her, because it was her dying wish and I had no relations. That is perfectly correct. If you will allow me to explain my reasons for not telling you the full story until now, I think you will find nothing discreditable in my motives. Then his face softened, he took my hand and drew me towards him. Don't stand there accusing me before I have had a chance to tell you my story. Sit here beside me. How can we quarrel when I loved your mother as you would have loved her if she had lived? I'm sorry I was rude. It was a shock finding out so suddenly. Who told you? No one. I discovered it for myself. It was obvious that he thought I was defending somebody. I thought he was going to try to find out who it was, but instead he said gently, "Your mother was beautiful in mind and body, and she would have been proud of you, Lucina. She was a priestess in the temple of Hera at Mykonae. She was dedicated to lifelong virginity, but she fell in love with a young Athenian. She loved him more than her sterile woes. You were conceived, and he persuaded her to flee with him to Athens. They hid in a poor quarter of the town with his foster mother, waiting for a boat to take them to Alexandria. It was the Olympiad of the games, and he yielded to the temptation of renewing his laurels. I think it must have been very difficult for him to relinquish the acclaim of the crowds, who had made him the most famous athlete in Greece. Your mother eagerly awaited his return. There had been a messenger to say that their ship would sail at dawn. She heard the lamentation of a crowd and in sudden terror ran out of the house. It was your father's name which echoed through the weeping throng. He had been killed in the last bout of the wrestling. She watched his body carried through the streets on a bier garlanded with the laurels of his companions. She said he looked as though he smiled in his sleep. No one could have told that his neck was broken. When she collapsed, the passerby carried her to my house. I heard her story and offered her the sanctuary of Elysium. In those days, there was only the cottage on the headland. It was not until I decided to live here permanently that I built this house. He smiled. It was because of your mother that I became a philosopher instead of a celebrated physician. Why did she change you? I tried by every means at my command to save her life, but I did not know how to win against the false gods which destroyed her. My skill was useless. It was only sufficient to convince me that she suffered from no bodily disease. Then why did she die? She believed herself guilty of your father's death, that in him the gods she worshipped had revenged themselves for her disloyalty. I tried to give her a sense of reality, but she refused to listen, saying that if I took away her fear of the gods, she would no longer be able to believe she would in time rejoin your father. I thought that when you were born, her love for a child would increase her will to live, but she had only been waiting to give you life before she felt free to stretch out her arms to death. Are you surprised, Lucina, that I tried to make you strong enough to resist the hideous infection of superstition? You resemble her so closely that often I fear for you. But I will protect you. I will teach you to accept reality, even if the process must estrange you from me. I beg of you to believe that only truth, unclouded intellect, can give you security. You want me to believe that she has no existence save in our memory? I know it, Lucina. Here and now are the place and the time of our living, not in some amorphous afterward which cowards conceive to hide their fear of death. You are wrong, Asclepius. I saw her this afternoon. If you don't believe me, ask Euripides. He was there too. How dare he contaminate your mind with his fantasy? I saw her, and I saw myself as a child of 3 years old for whom she lit a lamp. He leant back as though relieved. A child of three? This proves beyond all doubt that your visions was purely subjective. You left Elysium at the age of 2 months. You promised her to look after me, so why did you send me to the island? I was determined that you should not share her needless suffering. The influence of hereditary is strong, but not more so than the childhood environment. I wished you to be free from all contacts which might cause you to develop the mystical strain which had been dominant in the maternal parent. Elisa was loyal, obedient, and healthy, but incapable of abstract thought. Her husband was of the same type, and after due consideration was willing to swear that you should be kept in strict seclusion so that you should hear nothing appertaining to the supernatural. As a token of his acceptance of my wishes, I made him destroy his household god in my presence. I knew this would remove any temptation to break his word, for he would not likely invoke gods he thought he had insulted. He made a sound bargain, a clay image in exchange for a home and sufficient land to secure his future. Only the immediate future in exchange for immortality. You think it dishonest to barter a shadow for a substance? No, but I think it's cruel. Unfortunately, a physician who has the courage of his convictions must be prepared for the patient to see only the temporary pain instead of the final health, which will result from the removal of a malign growth. You still haven't been able to explain how a baby could remember the pattern on a carpet, the position of a chest, the color of her mother's eyes. Do you? He smiled indulgently, but his mood had altered. He was no longer sympathetic to affection. I described the room, but though he agreed that every detail was accurate, he remained unconvinced. A most brilliant demonstration that the perception of infants is far more accurate than it generally accepted. It is also illuminating that the baby had already developed a concept of itself at a more advanced stage. You were in the room when your mother died. I had no idea that the end was so close, or of course I should have taken you away. Already you were conscious of the difference between light and darkness and found the lamp reassuring. Your mother was afraid of the dark. You must have contracted this fear during the prenatal period. You see how interesting it all is when the process is explained. I made no reply, and he took my silence for answer and assent. The influence of the symbolic name is most gratifying. You were her daughter, the projection of herself, which might well have proved strong enough to combat her fears. What did she call you? Lucina, the lamp, or in a wider aspect, the light bringer. She tried to protect herself from her fear of death as darkness by a pitiful belief that the light of affection could endure beyond mortality. The symbol of that light was the child with a lamp. He crossed the room to take a small terracotta lamp from the table on which he wrote all his theses. This was beside her when she died. It is unchanged, but she will never use it again. He held it between his hands, looking down at the small, clear flame. For a moment he seemed young and curiously defenseless. Then he said gently, "I'm very grateful, Lucina, that you have told me she did not die in fear. She was so afraid of the dark." What could I say to comfort him or myself? Perhaps he was right. Perhaps I had only seen her symbolic vision, which somehow had lingered in the room when she died. He had told me that ghosts were only a subjective image created by one person and perceived objectively by another. But even if he were wrong, how could I be so cruel as to tell him that after the physician had watched her body die, the philosopher had left her soul alone in the dark, because he was too blind to see beyond the horizon of mortality? So the next chapter is entitled Sea Urchin, and it's number 6. I got the sequence a little wrong on my BitChute. Have a lovely Tuesday. It's Halloween, 31st of October.